Okay, so I guess, yeah, it sounds like I'm attached. And get the screen back up. Takes a second. Very good. Well, I'm delighted to be here. Certainly want to express my appreciation to Laura for all the hard work she's done organizing this, and Katie Fries and Nardita for the support they've given to the whole operation. So I'm, as my title indicates, I haven't got something definite to teach you or to propose. I just have odd little bits of general relativity and gravity that intrigue me, and I will try to answer some or pose some questions, and I'm not even sure that they're not only my questions. I think the first one, someone else mentioned, can a graviton be identified? Will we ever have our hopes of actually seeing a quantum of gravity? And I ended up doing something else that brought me close to that, so I will show you that. And then there's this question of whether the Hawking radiation, which we are concentrating our attention on for most of this meeting, the question is, will we ever have evidence that there is such a thing? I don't think there's any serious contention that it was not a soundly based theoretical prediction. It's been looked at from so many different points of view that give consistent answers. So all we know about quantum mechanics and gravity, the best we can fit them together, the Hawking radiation seems inevitable. But whether it has played a role in the development or the future of the universe remains an open question to me, at least. We're pretty, as I've heard other people mention, the black holes that we actually have on our list of almost objects in the observed sky that are almost certainly black holes, none of those would be currently losing mass due to Hawking radiation, because they're gaining mass from so many other things, including at the lowest level, the 3-degree microwave cosmic background radiation, which is much hotter than any of the black holes we know about. Now, as the universe expands, things will change. I haven't tried to follow that, because eventually the universe might expand enough so that black holes can actually begin losing mass. On the other hand, who knows whether they will have gained so much in the meantime that the starting point has changed and they're even colder than we think of them now. So we don't know what's going on here. I guess I have to keep occasionally talking to this computer or it gives up. There we are. Okay. Fine. So then there's all these questions of what goes on, possibly the famous firewall just inside the horizon. And that's something I have strong doubts about, because I can't, A, the horizon as such is normally defined in terms of the ultimate fate of light rays, and we can't look that deep into the universe to know what's going to happen to any particular light ray. The universe may change quite a bit in the future, so we're not sure what it should be. But another thing that I want to tell you about is what I call the quiet dog effects, and I'll explain that farther. But that's not where you see something, but where you don't see something and can draw conclusions from that. So that's a few questions that bother me a bit. And here are a few of the things as we see. Whoop, how is this playing out on the screen? I really wanted to see the tops of these documents there. If we can get the whole slide on one screen, there we are, much better. These are things that I want to tell you about. I'm going the wrong direction. There we are. So the questions And now there are some of these things that I will try to mention. These are the pieces, just odd bits of relativity that amuse me or attract my attention, and I don't know how to fit them together to make an overall picture, but I hope some of you will think about some of them. So some that I'm going to go through, this is this list of odd pieces of gravity. Work of radiation, I'll talk to you more about, the quiet dog effect. Here I have already mentioned this, that black holes aren't losing mass right now. And if we go instead of to horizons, as I mentioned, because they have, you have to know the whole future of the universe to know exactly where the horizon is to great precision. You want to depend on apparent horizons, but these have the strange property of being correlations between data at space-like related points. You have to look at a sphere, or a topological sphere, and find out that the light rays, all the light rays are going in at all points of that sphere. And that's at some fixed time, and therefore these different points are not talking to each other. And so it's hard to see how they're going to reliably talk about producing some effect. Other things I'll mention here, the chemist's thermodynamics. That is the thermodynamics you can do without talking about the constituents of matter, but just talking about its behavior, as chemists did in the 19th century, some of whom didn't believe in atoms, but nevertheless they believed in Carnot cycle and things like that. So the chemist's thermodynamics doesn't really work for gravity. I think I'm going to say that more length a little bit later. But we do, of course, if you accept that the chemist's idea of entropy is inapplicable, we still have to see whether that means that some of its difficulties will be reflected in the various statistical or information-related concepts of gravity. So now I'll start on the first of those odd topics, what I call workout radiation. The thought occurred to me that I could become slightly immortal by sending out a signal that would go through the universe and witness my existence. And the simplest signal I can think of gravitationally, because gravitational waves don't get absorbed very rapidly, is just take a couple kilogram weights and do a changing quadrupole moment, okay? Now, I'm generating gravitational waves according to classical gravity, and I wanted to ask myself, what hope do we have that those waves will ever be visible? And so I went to this and raised the question of, in view of semi-classical quantum mechanics, does it really look like a wave, what I've just done? Is the gravitational effects of that really look like a wave? Of course, it would be a long wave, like one light second in length, which is a bit several times the distance from here to the moon, so they're big, long wavelength things. But anyway, how well does it work? So I asked how many gravitons were in that wave. In one cycle of radiation, how many gravitons were involved? And you could figure that out because you know the intensity of the radiation from the quadrupole formula. And you know h bar omega gives you the energy of one graviton. So you just do that calculation, try to get the numbers straight, which I don't guarantee, but I think they're not too bad. I came out with this result that the number of gravitons per cycle of radiation, per wavelength, in this purported wave had a bunch of numbers that depended on my actually writing down a quadrupole moment for this motion. The mass, my kilogram in units of Planck masses, and the size of the quadrupole that I'm changing, in terms of the wavelength of the gravitational wave, which, as I say, is this one light second. So we could put all those numbers in and see how much of a classical wave I'm generating. And the result is, well, first check that the what we think is really classical works, the Hulse-Taylor pulsar, turns out that formula gives you about 10 to the 65 gravitons per cycle, so it's a good classical wave. We don't have to worry about it. But for this stuff that I was just generating, the formula gives 10 to the minus 14th. That means one graviton for each year, each 10 to the 7th years, 10 to the 7th seconds per year, and another 10 to the 7th before you get a graviton. So I would have to keep doing my morning exercises for 10 million years to get even one graviton out into the universe. So it's not a very efficient way to immortalize yourself, especially since you had to live forever to get it started. Right, okay, so that's that one. So, but now we're going to work towards to see whether there's any hope on the intermediaries between the 10 to the 65 and the 10 to the minus 14 classicality measure. Is there something, if you could ever find a system produced fortunately for us by the universe, and it's been pretty good at delivering all kinds of interesting things on all kinds of scales, but if you could find a system that's had about 1,000 gravitons per period, by then in the waves that were coming out would show shot noise, because some of them would have 980 and some would have 1,020 gravitons, and there would be this variety, and it would be like Brownian motion showing your atoms from the statistics of motion. You would show that there were gravitons if you could get. So that's the challenge for all the astrophysics-oriented people who know what crazy things can be found in the universe, to find something where the missing radiation would, being controlled by the quantum principles, would indicate the quantum principles were playing a name. So the fact that we're looking for something where quantum mechanics prevented things from happening, like it didn't let me radiate gravitational waves, I call these quiet dog facts. And by going to Google and putting in the dog that didn't bark, I came out with somebody who found this Sherlock Holmes story I remembered, and it even excerpted exactly what I wanted. And so this is a story where Sherlock is investigating a crime where a racehorse was either stolen or killed, I forget which, but certainly the trainer was killed. And so Sherlock is getting informed by the sheriff who'd looked into this crime, and sheriff says, "Is there to Holmes, is there any other point to which you would wish to draw my attention?" Sherlock Holmes says, "To the curious incident of the dog in the nighttime." Well, the sheriff said, "The dog did nothing in the nighttime." Holmes says, "That was the curious incident. Why did the dog do nothing?" And draws to the conclusion that whoever was involved in this was well known to the dog, and therefore that cut the list of suspects down immensely. So we're looking for cases where we would have liked things to happen and they didn't for some important reason. Okay, so there's been a lot of physics done with the quiet dog arguments. One of the earliest ones was Einstein in 1907. That's after special relativity, but 5 years before the Bohr atom. And quantum mechanics was barely begun with the Einstein's contributions in 1905. But here he comes up with another one. He said that, if you have a solid, like a piece of aluminum or copper or whatnot, the chemists knew and worried about the specific heats. Instead of getting, they thought it was made out of atoms, which would oscillate be able to absorb energy. And if you want a half kT per degree of freedom, you get a specific heat of, I think it's 6 calories per mole or something. I forget the number. But anyway, there's a specific heat, which at moderate temperatures, the various metals that have been checked agreed, but at low temperatures it wasn't working. So somehow at low temperatures, a lot of these oscillations weren't occurring. And Einstein came up with the idea here, well, that's because the temperatures are so low that the one quantum that we have available exceeds what's available at that temperature. You can't get a whole quantum's worth of energy that is a quantum in one of these oscillators, and so some of those oscillations just are unable to participate. So that's one of the early things where the absence of oscillation led to a conclusion supporting quantum mechanics to a significant degree, convinced some physical chemists to take it seriously, very early in the game. And there are, of course, lots of other examples where we get somewhere by things that didn't happen. Neutrinos from the middle 1930s until 1955 or so, the only way we knew anything about neutrinos is that they weren't there. No one had seen a neutrino. You saw beta decay taking place. There were electrons coming out, but some energy was unseen. It had disappeared. And either you gave up energy conservation or you said, there's something we're not seeing that took it away. And so neutrinos developed for 2 decades without anyone ever having caught a neutrino. And then finally that was done. Likewise, our present stage with gravitational waves is the same situation. The Hulse-Taylor pulsar is losing energy. We can see that. No one's seen the energy yet. Where is it going? Well, no one had a good excuse where it could go in conventional, earlier days conventions of what could it be absorbing or hiding that energy. And it fit perfectly with the idea that it was gravitational waves. So the fact that there is energy losses that are unseen, that is the resulting emitted energy nobody has seen yet, we're still hoping to see it in the next few years from similar things. But anyway, that's again one. And the whole solar neutrino problem. Solar neutrinos were not reaching the Earth in the numbers that were seemed to be necessary to account for the energy generation in the sun. And that was a mystery for a couple decades, I believe, until finally people figured out that there was these neutrino oscillations and the sun was emitting plenty of neutrinos, but they changed into mu neutrinos, which couldn't be detected by the detectors. So there are all these situations. And so the thing is that we were looking for more places in the universe where some of these things might let us draw conclusions. The most interesting would be, of course, if you could find something about the quantum that way. I don't think you could see energies. They would be too small. But if there are EPH, Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen type quantum entanglements, it could be that the phase of one piece of that entangled pair of degrees of freedom might never be seen, but if it could be shown not to be there, maybe we could conclude that there had to be some.
Why do you say quantum limits are inhibiting the radiation?
My example of this radiation, I can't get a wave out there because I can't generate a whole quantum's worth. I can't generate a quantum's one. I can't generate one graviton by the work I do in a half an hour or even.
You're just creating a weak gravitational wave. That's okay.
Well, it's a weak gravitational wave, but one that can only be seen after millions of years. So the first many cycles of that wave aren't there. Before the first quantum comes, you haven't seen the wave. And if it typically takes 10 million years to get the first graviton out, why, it's going to be hard to see.
Maybe some detector of waves could see it anywhere.
Yeah, well, I think it's like the specific heats. It's not that, what? Yeah, the photoelectric effect. That's right.
Well, but it depends on the detector.
Right. So anyway, if you can get around this, go to it. That's the whole point. So we would like to see some of these effects possible. Now, another whole set of questions that I referred to in connection with the definition of a apparent horizon. If you wanted to define, so this paradox is what Einstein called the spooky accident at a distance, when there are actual correlations established at space-like separated points that you're unable to use that correlation to convey information from one of those points to the other, but nevertheless you can audit the effect after the fact and see that the correlations had existed when some measurements were made in the past. So you, EPR is sort of a three-stage process. You produce an entangled pair of something or other. Those things, when space-like separated from each other, get measured. You can't tell anything peculiar about that. Either of those measurements didn't look funny. But an audit sometime later, when that information was able to be collected and compared, you will discover, yes, you never get a violation of whatever spin conservation or whatever was they were controlling. So you can, so there's this correlation between things that are not talking to each other. And we may need that if nature is to base anything like a firewall on an apparent horizon, because an apparent horizon is something that you can verify, and presumably to get out the guns and shoot energy at you, nature would have to know that that apparent horizon was there, and that means it had to know information correlating space-like related points on the sphere that defines the trapped surface that guarantees that there will be an horizon someplace outside of it. So that whole thing might be needed, the very quantum mechanical things, to get an effect. My own inclination would be to guess that nature is not that clever and is not going to produce any such effects on macro-sized black holes. But anyway, you need it. So, here's just a little more information, most of which I've said, about the EPR relationships. But the thing that's not so often emphasized is the fact that after the experiment is half done, two things, whatever they were, a spin zero particle giving decaying into two spin a half particles, and then if you measure one of those spins one place, the other has to agree to add up to zero. If the original, say a pi zero meson, started it with zero spin, the total spin of the decay products has to be zero. But they can't talk to each other. Since they're space-like related, depending on how you slice space-time, you don't even know which one came first. You could have a slicing this way or a slicing that way in your space-time diagram, and changes which one of those is assigned a time earlier than the other. But you can collect the lab books from these measurements, bring them together at some later stage, and see, did it ever happen that the spins didn't agree as they were supposed to? Of course, if one of them is measured on the z-axis, is another on the x-axis, they're is nothing from knowing the first bit that tells you anything about the second one. So in those cases, but you can design experiments so you know in advance you're going to keep doing this with spins measured in the direction where they do influence, where they have to add up properly. And I would think that on an optical table these days, using photons instead of spinning particles or whatnot, people are clever, they could do Einstein, Podolsky, Rosen on an optical table, because after all, the distance on a table is just a few nanoseconds. The speed of light is 1 nanosecond per foot. The only useful bit of English measurement I know. So if you could, generate a tangled pair of something, get it out on your table a couple meters apart, quickly measure, that's the important thing. Now you've got to be able to do the measurement of polarization or whatever it is within a picosecond or something, instead of, so you've got time to record it in a semi-macroscopic piece of apparatus, then sends the information on later to get checked by the auditor to see whether it's consistent with the predicted correlations. So those kind of things can be done. But I don't think you're going to need it. However, this whole APR get business, as other people have mentioned, gets troublesome here. That's why we worry about it. Because if one of these two particles, instead of just going to the other side of your optical bench, was sent off into the universe and gobbled up by a black hole, why, the auditor does not have a chance to check it. Does that make a difference? If you can't check that this correlation had existed, maybe it didn't. But so anyway, the whole idea that some of these are in principle uncheckable because of experiments that fell into a black hole or whatever. Of course, there are lots of other ways to not be able to check it. Most things get sent out into the universe, don't get seen by anybody. That's the famous Olber's paradox. You look into the night sky and it's dark, which indicates that most of the photons being sent out by matter in the early universe don't survive to be absorbed. And we don't know if we calculate what's going to happen to the light from the sun. Most of it doesn't get absorbed in the solar system or in surrounding plasmas, but we'll end up, you may as well model it with a de Sitter horizon in the future to say it's lost, but it's effectively lost in most cases anyway. So there are all these things that we have to worry about in a curved space-time that are different. If you do EPR in Minkowski space-time, it's always in principle possible for the results of two experiments to somehow get compared in the future. But in curved space-time, either due to the black hole horizons, or due to the Minkowski horizon, or due to just the emptiness of space and things unable to be caught up with, there get to be things that you, in principle, cannot compare about that. So,
excuse me, Charlie. So,
yes.
So on that point, if the auditor were to fall inside the black hole also, he could do the auditing.
If he got there soon enough, because
if the information got to him soon enough.
When you fall into a black hole, all the material that goes in gets crushed into a singularity pretty quickly, and if you're a little late getting started trying to chase it, you can never catch it.
That's true. Yeah. So yeah. He has to get there quick enough.
Yes.
I also think about this point, because I mentioned it briefly the other day.
Microphone.
Do we have a microphone?
Yeah, so I'd just like to also take up this point, because I mentioned briefly a calculation by Jared Milburn at the University of Queensland. What you can do is, in de Sitter space, you can solve exactly for the propagation of electrons. So you can take an electron, a pair of entangled electrons, and actually then figure out what happens to that entanglement in de Sitter space. And also, I think he did it for the case of accelerating electrons. And the upshot is that the radiation associated with the horizons destroys the entanglement. It decoheres the entanglement. That had better be the case, because we could make a black hole from a ball of n particles entangled with n exterior particles, and we would then have exponentially more hair in the black hole than you would predict classically. We would have n parameters that we would know internal to the black hole from keeping that information. And so it seems that it's an inevitable part of the properties of black holes that the entanglement has to be destroyed, in the case of the black hole, by the Hawking radiation. So I'm pretty sure that's the resolution of this. And so we don't need to worry about the audit.
Okay, thank you. Well, now I go on to my next topic, which is gravitational entropy. Again, as another puzzle piece, peculiarity of gravity, is this whole idea that if you try to use strictly thermodynamics to worry about gravitational entropy, you don't feel comfortable about the results. Of course, when entropy was first all the rage in the late 19th century, why people were talking about the heat death of the universe, how eventually everything would come to the same temperature and there would be no evolution, nothing exciting would happen.
Well, actually, if there's a cosmological constant, then we suffer a different kind of heat death after all in the long run.
That's right. Yeah, we have to look at a lot different. But anyway, the point is that nowadays, the talk is not about the heat death of the universe. As you say, with the cosmological constant, it looks like it's going to just empty itself around most remaining pieces. But what we do is look back in the early universe, and we see the heat birth of the universe. Nothing looks more like a high entropy equilibrium state than the various stages of the hot Big Bang, where, except for fluctuations that fortunately get amplified eventually, the content of the universe is essentially a hot uniform plasma. And what really happens, of course, is that gravity doesn't treat entropy in a way that that chemistry does, and that's because self-gravitating systems have negative specific heat. That's been pointed out several times. I have a few references that will probably show up in the next slide or so. But anyway, the virial theorem tells you that for Newtonian interactions, I'm thinking of a globular cluster or something like that, if it should boil off a few stars, it would lose energy and collapse a little bit, and everything would move faster. Yes?
That's a crucial
right. And, but of course, the crucial thing about negative specific heats is they tell you that systems are not stable and you can't expect equilibrium.
Right.
And that's what makes our universe so interesting, is that it looked uniform at the beginning and that wasn't stable, and it began all this structure formation, which is related to the idea that you can export energy and get hotter. That's right. And therefore, my conclusion from this, and also as mentioned by Lyndon Bell, of course, talked strongly about the negative specific heats, but it was Fang Liji, I think, who first, to my knowledge, made it a central point of the development of the universe, development of structure in the universe, to think about that. He has this nice little book written for students in China, which got translated eventually into English. It's not very mathematical, but he goes through very simple physics and explains that there are these consequences of negative specific heats of gravitating systems. And
it's in one of the old editions of Landau-Lipschitz.
Uh-huh.
When they proved that specific heat must be positive, they have a little footnote and says, perhaps the student is wondering how stars can radiate energy and get hotter. Which, of course, the student is not wondering. And they say, oh, that's because our proof doesn't work with long-range forces.
Oh. Well, it doesn't.
It's some old edition of Landau Lifshitz.
It doesn't work with attractive forces, I think, was the critical
but actually,
problem.
But actually, I don't think they gave the right answer.
Uh-huh.
I think it's because the system is metastable.
Right. Yeah.
Which is more what Emil was saying.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, Fong made a big point of this and made a nice, clear case for the idea that this is one of the. Fong.
Oh, Fong.
Yeah. That this is one of the most critical features for understanding the universe and the fact that interesting structures have developed. And Freeman Dyson came up with that same idea quite independently and has published it a different place, but Fong had several years head start on that. So there are these references that take that viewpoint, and I think it's a very important viewpoint to realize that, A, that self-gravitating systems are only quasi-stable, but to the extent you want to treat that as near stability, they have negative specific heats. And secondly, the other thing to do is that the chemist's thermodynamics says you compute everything by having essentially reversible traps, paths from one place to another in your space of descriptors of the system. And unfortunately, as Oppenheimer and Snyder announced in the title of their paper on continuing gravitational collapse, that sufficiently large self-gravitating systems simply do not have a equilibrium from the point of view that they were taking, which is what you can see of the system. It's always changing. Well, it changes exponentially, so these days we tend not to think it's done, and that a black hole is a fixed object, at least the visible parts of it, and, in my opinion, much of the lost parts of it inside the horizon, which stay at curvatures less than what we're experiencing in this room now in some billion solar mass black holes. There's a lot of regions inside where I can't imagine the physics would be changed from the standard results of classical physics. And so we think there is a lot of physics going on there. But anyway, the conclusion is that I take is that you can't trust the 19th century concepts of entropy, which are independent of the construction at the reductionist level of what it is you're talking about, whether there are atoms or not, etc. Didn't matter to calculate the efficiency of steam engines. But I think that because this is true, we must say that the thermodynamic entropy ceases to be defined. We have to worry about whether or not when you introduce the more information-related ideas of entropy, how are they threatened by this fact that the effective field theory that looks at these things without the microscopic picture to back it up, whether that fails so badly that the microscopic picture has to be perhaps changed in some way. So that's a threat I think we have to worry about, and which I don't propose to give any answers to. So that's my collection of odd things about gravity that I wanted to tell you about.
If I have a box of gravity...
A box
microphone.
Of... Microphone, oh.
If I have a box of gravitons...
Yes.
Which is not too heavy, I'm allowed to think of it as a usual Planck gas, no?
Well, a box of gravitons is hard to arrange. You have to have a special universe to make the mean free path of a typical graviton shorter than the size of the universe. They're so hard to catch. Boxing.
You're worried that there's no walls.
Yeah, right. Yeah, so it's great to have. Well, this this gets us to a whole other thing that I haven't, I think, included in my list of slides today. Right. But that's, there's a class of objects, well, maybe I don't have that much more time either, class of laws of physics that I call evanescent laws, laws that work for a while and then get outwitted by nature. For instance, the Coulomb law loses its relevance once you're at JPL doing the ephemeris of the solar system. They don't include the charge of the planets in that, or the Coulomb forces between the planets and so forth. Why not? Because electromagnetism is too strong. It grabs everything and makes it pretty much neutral. And gravity is the only relevant force. So Coulomb's law is thrown in the wastebasket once you're doing the motion of planets in the solar system. Likewise, here we saw entropy is in danger. The chemist's entropy just doesn't apply once you get large gravitating systems. And energy, so I call that an evanescent law. It worked fine over huge domains, but then it reached its limits. It wasn't, it either was undefined or wasn't behaving right, or it didn't give you any insight of the system, or something was going wrong with it. Energy has the same problem, that once you've got what's now called dark energy, the idea of conservation of energy isn't getting anywhere. It doesn't help you side any problems, because the universe just has to expand a little bit. However much it wants to expand, all the necessary energy is there. You don't have any limitations on the expansion from the conservation of energy. You take a sample of the universe, you pull on it at all sides, expand it, and the work you've done pulling on it leaves the density inside the same, even though you've got a much bigger volume. And so the conservation of energy is somehow being cheated out of relevance by nature's ability to figure out this scheme of exponential expansion and essentially cosmological constant type stuff. So we'd have to expect that every once in a while, laws that we've lived with for years and loved are either going to be irrelevant or occasionally don't really fit and often don't provide any insight, so you can ignore them while working with in some other method. But anyway, that's just a few extra added remarks. Thank you. Katie.
So we have Advanced LIGO taking data very soon, and they're expecting to be able to see collisions of black holes. They're going to see that they expect to see gravity waves from colliding black holes. And I'm wondering what can we learn from that, other than the fact that you've got these are giant objects colliding. Is that the only thing that matters, or do you learn something about black holes? I don't know the answer to that question.
Well, my guess will be that things will go as expected, and you don't need anything except classical. You don't need any quantum mechanics. The GR will work perfectly well for solar mass black holes, or intermediate mass, or huge black holes. All those things probably can live their lives essentially as handled by the numerical implementations, which one hopes is giving a picture of what the actual solutions of the Maxwell's of the Einstein equations would look like, and whatever's going on deep inside the black holes, where there could be quantum mechanics or new laws of physics at high energies or who knows what, whatever's going on in there will be irrelevant to what we can see.
So just to follow up on the question, well, a comment to the question, if we had two astrophysical objects that in spiral and collide, and we compare the case where those two objects are both black holes, or one black hole and one neutron star, or two neutron stars of equal mass, then the initial in spiral wave would be the same, but the final merger and ring down waveform would be different. So from observation, we can distinguish between astrophysical states that contain black holes and ones that don't. Mm-hmm. Neutron star would be different. Yeah. So we could learn something about that. In the neutron star case, we actually would like to be able to learn something about the equation of state in the interior, which again is telling us something quite quantum mechanical. So right. We may learn something about nuclear matter from seeing a gravitational wave.
Yeah, not only that, but in the case of if they were two black holes, you hope to be able to check some of the details from the ring down times, these special frequencies
that
are associated with black holes when they've been disturbed. So if you have enough signal-to-noise ratio to begin to see that kind of stuff, it will have severe tests on whether classical non-quantum general relativity is in charge of the situation.
Getting Laura. Back to the very difficult, heavy-duty topics, the entropy and the EPR tests. And when it comes to the thermodynamic entropy, I mean, I completely agree. Of course, we all know that gravity is a negative heat capacity system, so it would do the opposite of what normal matter would do, which is a positive heat capacity system. But we do have an out-of-equilibrium thermodynamics, which is well defined, so I was a bit confused. Why can't we use that? Although the system, as you said, will be out of equilibrium, the self-gravitating system will be out of equilibrium, but we can still define a thermodynamic entropy for this out of equilibrium system, correct?
Okay, I'm not familiar enough with that. I know the field exists, but I've never studied it. So if it can handle the things, great. I'm just not familiar with it.
Okay.
Obviously, you're right in saying that that's an appropriate tool to attack these problems with.
Yeah, and the second question was the EPR, using that on a black hole setting, which sounds extremely interesting, but and that's related to what the comment Paul made. If Hawking radiation can break this entanglement for two space-like separated events that are correlated with one another, wouldn't we run into that same trouble of firewalls? Because breaking the correlation, that energy has to go somewhere, it has to build up somewhere. So if we wanted to run experiments to test EPR on the horizon of a black hole and we wanted to break this correlation, to do the auditing part, wouldn't we end up with surplus energy, which is incredibly blue-shifted near the horizon?
Yeah, I would think that's the same thing. That is, in the usual EPR, there's no energy considerations. If you do measure things in the compatible directions so you can check them, or the incompatible directions so that they're independent in what the expected measurement are, all those things take place with exactly no penalty of energy which way you do it.
But in this case, you are very near the horizon, where half of the events are beyond the horizon, and you are just trying to obtain information being outside.
Yeah, but it's only the information that's changing. It's not the mass or the velocity or any other property of the object that fell in. It's only the phase of the wave function is somehow getting lost its correlation with something outside.
Alice falls into a black hole. So these calculations have been done. Milburn, I mentioned, but also Robert Mann, the Perimeter Institute, looking at one entanglement of Dirac fields in non-inertial frames. So I think the conclusion is that entanglement does not survive one of the pairs going down the black hole. And as I said earlier, it better not survive, otherwise we've got additional information about the interior of the black hole over and above what is given to us by the no hair theorem. I don't know how that fits in with what we were hearing about from Stephen and Malcolm earlier in the week about the BMS hair, but that's classical.
Yeah, I just want to remark that correlations on the apparent horizon giving rise to effects is basically exactly what I was talking about in my talk. There's no reason why there can't be macroscopic quantum effects, even on the scale of a horizon, apparent horizon of a large black hole.
Yeah, you were making the analogy to large objects that
and
are...
And there's no, and you know, it doesn't violate any causality because, of course, it came from some initial condition in the original collapse. In the same way, EPR doesn't violate causality.
Yeah, well, it doesn't violate causality, but can it provoke something happening locally? That was my question. Know enough to provoke...
I mean, if
the kindling of this firewall.
Yeah. Well, I wouldn't call it a firewall because that's a different term. But
right.
But there can be such effects, and that's what the vacuum polarization in certain states actually shows. I mean, you know, you can argue about whether those states are going to be produced, and that's of course a dynamical calculation has to be done, but. That doesn't violate any fundamental principles in quantum mechanics.
Right.
I just wanted to comment on your remark about energy conservation. I think the lesson from, say, dark energy is that energy conservation is fine, but it just that the fundamental energy conservation is the local. The covariant divergence of the stress tensor being zero. That's the thing that is still really valid. Of course, it doesn't make much sense to talk about a global a global integrated energy being constant. And of course, we don't really know whether the dark energy is W equals minus one or some other value. And of course, the local conservation law is very relevant in trying to probe that, what the nature of the dark energy really is observationally.
Yeah. Of course, I always like to think that dark energy is like the early universe where there was also a false vacuum and an exponential expansion that went on for some time, and then somehow it hit a limit and all this wonderful expanded space turned into all kinds of matter. Well, nature likes to play theme and variations. It gave us gauge theories with the E&M, and then after we studied things a little farther, we found there were gauge theories all over the place. So if nature did a big inflation a long time in the past, maybe we're just entering another inflation on a different time scale. Instead of having the time scale be the crossing time of a meson or something like that, the time scale will be the scale of the e-folding of the present universe under the so-called dark energy, and therefore instead of a heartbeat being a second, a heartbeat will be 10 to the 10th billion years or something like that. But if there's plenty of time, so interesting things could happen. They just happen more slowly.
But I think it's worth recalling that the observational evidence for inflation doesn't necessarily prove that it was de Sitter inflation. After all, power law expansion models with a sufficiently high enough exponent also fit the data just as well as de Sitter expansion. Just de Sitter,
anything superluminal
is simpler. So that's what people assume, but there's no. We don't really know that. Actually, I thought I'd maybe throw in another comment. If you have, you recall, of course, so many years ago, Roger Penrose had an idea about gravitational entropy as being associated with Weyl curvature.
Right.
But I think that idea.
What kind of curvature?
Weyl curvature. I think that idea has been pretty much discredited. And Paul and I and Don Page wrote a paper against that. But of course, it's. I think part of his idea, what motivated him, was the idea of perhaps thinking of stochastic gravity waves. Even if you can't put gravitons in a box, you could certainly imagine the universe filled with some bath of stochastic gravitational radiation, and it's perfectly reasonable to attach an entropy to that.
So I wanted to comment back on this question about the future of the universe with the cosmological constant. if it is really a constant, then we do die a heat death, because the universe keeps cooling off, but until eventually you reach the temperature of the microwave background, and at that point, in order to, as living, anything living has to metabolize, there's no way of eliminating the heat anymore. So if it's a constant, we do die a heat death. Now, if it's not a constant, then you can sort of eke along a probably unpleasant existence to our taste, but anyway, you can keep going. But
I want to make a comment about your first point, which you didn't really mention, which is, can we ever detect a graviton?
Great.
Now, the graviton and the photon are degenerate systems. They both have zero mass. So one should be able to mix with the other. And there's a paper by myself and Georg Raufeld. We were mainly concerned with axions, but we also treated gravitons, where in a magnetic field, which you need to make up the missing spin, the photon can turn into a graviton, and vice versa. So conceivably, a high-energy photon, or maybe better, a high-energy graviton coming from someplace could produce a very high-energy photon. Of course, the rate is rather small till you get near to Planck energies. And you need large regions of uniform gravitational fields, but it's uniform magnetic fields. But it's not conceptually impossible.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, I think, I think the whole question of the entropy of black holes and what it really means is something I think is far from settled. But, we have the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy, which I would think represents some basically ignorance about what's inside the black hole in a very coarse-grained sense. We also have some sort of von Neumann entropy at the black hole, measuring number of quantum degrees of freedom that are inside the black hole. And I don't think those two entropies in general have much to do with each other. Perhaps the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy represents a maximum possible von Neumann entropy, but even that's debatable. At least for a young black hole, the number of quantum degrees of freedom excited, above vacuum, I mean, I'm not counting, is presumably much less than the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy. So I'm just throwing that out and wonder if people want to disagree, that's fine. But
suggestion. I've been trying to understand it, and I still am a little bit puzzled as how it will.
Go back and explain what this is about.
What?
Go back and
we're talking about the talks on Tuesday about super translations.
Well, I think there will be quite a lot of that from Stephen.
Maybe I'll write them on the board.
What?
There will be quite a lot of that from Stephen tomorrow morning.
He will discuss that. Well.
So what is the schedule tomorrow?
We have 1 hour tomorrow. That's like all of us have to take a vote.
Take a vote.
After we have discussed all these topics with us. But the next speaker is Kurt Lobstone. suggestion?
Well,
have Malcolm.
I think it might be useful to have a preliminary discussion, so you can tell me if I. I know I'm confused, but I'm not sure on what level. Let me see if I can, in my simple the way I understand, recapitulate, Malcolm, what I think you said on Tuesday, and as I understand that the idea of the super transverse. So you go back first to the BMS group for asymptotically flat space time. As I understand that, that's a way of encoding all the information that could possibly escape in gravity waves. Is that a fair statement? That the you have a asymptotically flat space time in which gravity waves could be radiated off to scribe plus.
So in actual fact, what happens is that
you should talk to them.
Use the microphone.
Does this work? So what happens in gravitational radiation in asymptotically flat space times is that as gravitational radiation passes through scry, it induces a BMS transformation. So the particular BMS transformation in question encodes the information from the Bondi news function. But I would imagine that there are other things that it could encode, well, could be encoded, that it does not include. So I think there's more information in gravitational radiation than just found in the BMS transformation.
Okay,
I'm not absolutely certain of that.
But at least the discussion of supertranslation in that sense is a discussion of at least some of the information carried by gravity waves.
Yes,
to scribe
correct.
Plus.
Yes, that's okay, absolutely
so that's,
correct.
That's the first, I think, as I understand what you're telling us, though, that when the corresponding supertranslations on the horizon are encoding information that could go down the black hole.
Yes, well, I think what we should do is take one step back first. At scry plus, there are going to be a collection of charges which contain some of this information.
Right.
And there is a similar collection of charges on the horizon.
Mm-hmm.
That's a classical statement,
right?
But if you ask me about quantum mechanical information, I do not know how to make the link between that and those charges.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's first understand it at the classical level. As I understand, the charges on the horizon are encoding information about waves that go that enter a black hole.
That's absolutely correct.
So the supertranslations or the collection of conserved charges are telling us about things that went across the horizon.
That's correct.
So, of course, so as you pointed out, that there is a certain sense in which black holes have an infinite amount of hair.
That's also correct.
Now, of course, people like John Wheeler, I think, were aware of this sort of thing, and their statement about black holes having no hair was referring to what observers far away would be able to actually observe after a finite time.
At I0, yes.
That is that the effects on the horizon apparently exponentially decay as seen by the distant observers. So I think the question I'm wondering about is what's the next step? If you want to use this in trying to solve the information problem, then somehow this information, I can understand formally that the information of like gravity waves, for example, going across the horizon is encoded there. But how does that get out?
Well, I think that the next step to try to take would be to attempt to answer the question that Stephen asked during my talk, which is, can you use this to calculate the entropy of a black hole?
Mm-hmm.
So I've spent the last day or so making attempts at doing that. I have not really had a great deal of success at the moment. Although one thing, well, the basic problem is that there's an infinite amount of hair.
Yeah.
That means that you're dealing with systems with infinite numbers of degrees of freedom. And the one thing that is clear is that black holes do not have an infinite number of degrees
right.
of freedom. The entropy is a nice function. It's sort of bounded. It's bounded by the mass squared, which is faster than most things, but nevertheless, it is bounded by that. In order to get an answer that looks like the area, what seems, at least what I have to do to get any answer at all, would be to apply some kind of length scale cutoff on the horizon. That seems to me to be
Can you say that again?
In order to get any finite answer, I at least had to impose some kind of length scale cutoff on the horizon.
You say a cutoff?
Cutoff, yes.
Cutoff, okay.
Could you put it in a box? Would that do?
No, because the problem, the reason for the divergence is the fact that the number of modes on the horizon has no bound. So essentially, the super translations are.
So technically, we have the same problem if we consider a box of thermal radiation. The number of states we can have at arbitrarily low energy is arbitrarily large. And yet, there's a finite amount of entropy in radiation at a finite temperature.
Yes, that comes about because you've got a Boltzmann factor which cuts things off for you.
Well, something
here
cuts
it is not clear that you do.
Oh, yeah.
So.
It's on.
So I need to talk a bit louder.
Yeah.
Okay.
Please speak into the microphone.
I was thinking.
It would help if you think loudly too.
Is this?
The problem could be resolved by imposing a length scale cutoff on the horizon. Putting it in a box isn't going to help, because putting the black hole in a box isn't going to do anything about high angular momentum modes on the horizon. Essentially, the angular momentum on the horizon is classified by the number of, basically by spherical harmonics. Those are unbounded. In L can go up as much as you like, and it's that divergence which causes a problem. But nevertheless, if you think about how these modes behave on the horizon, they'll have nodes, they'll oscillate, and if you thought that there had to be a cutoff because you couldn't have too many oscillations, that is to say there was some kind of length scale on the horizon, then you could cut it off and get a reasonable answer, and it would be proportional to the area. However, I don't know that that's a sensible thing to do, and the problem with length scale cutoffs is to make sure that you have a sensible way of doing this that doesn't violate Lorentz invariants. Faye is more of an expert on not violating Lorentz invariants with finite length schemes than I am, so maybe she could tell us a bit more about that. The only way in which I could justify or hope that this is not as bad as it sounds to have a length scale cutoff would be to say, well, this only is working on null surfaces and they're going to be a bit special. But that's very ad hoc.
Yeah, well, one of the thoughts that occurred to me is perhaps something along the line, and it's unfortunate that Gerard de Tooft isn't here now, because he made some comments, I think, after both yours and Stephen's talks, which are related, I think, to the idea that he had perhaps 20 years ago of interactions between ingoing modes and outgoing modes leading to a well-defined S matrix. But there's certainly, as I understand, his idea is that if you have ingoing modes that enter the horizon, which would be essentially what you're dealing with in your formalism, those will scatter in some way off of outgoing modes, and that could leave some imprint and hence some correlations in the outgoing Hawking radiation. But the part, at least to me, that it seems missing, I would like to, if anyone understands it, clarify, is what it seems like there's still something carried across the horizon that is not encoded in those modes. I mean, I think Gerard is trying to define an S matrix. He was hoping to find some theory in which black hole evaporation could be defined by an S matrix, which would then clearly be a unitary process. But until you can say what happens to the modes that go across the horizon and that information, that you're still dealing with the same problem that I think, as Jorma talked about in his talk, of the correlations between the things across the horizon and outside the horizon. There still seems to be a paradox.
I'm not going to disagree with you. I have no idea how information crossing the horizon can be completely preserved. For it to be completely preserved would require you to violate the no-cloning theorem. Certainly some of the information that is passing through is going to get in.
Right.
And I don't see how you can get all of it. However,
well, how,
But nevertheless, I think that the matter should be investigated further.
But I thought the whole idea of yours and Stephen's approach is to solve the information.
Well, what we have done is to identify an infinite collection of charges.
Please enter the security pin for this conference now.
Who's that? Sorry.
That's just the automatic voice of the system.
It's to identify an infinite collection of charges which should assist us in understanding what is going on. I don't know that it's a solution to the whole problem. However, I must say that Stephen is rather more optimistic than I sound.
Okay. Well, I guess what I'm doing is I'm expressing a little bit of skepticism that this program can work unless you can deal with what happens to the information that goes across the horizon.
Well, I think that's fine. I mean, I'm not going to object to that.
Malcolm, but if you have a super translation invariance of some scattering matrix, why do you need to introduce a cutoff? Unitarity is already built in there. The moment you have a cutoff, you break unitarity and all the other bad stuff that goes with it, cutoff dependence and all that.
Well, no, the question that I was trying to answer was, can you use these thoughts to generate a sensible, to generate the correct entropy for black holes? And what I was saying was that unless I introduced a cutoff, I did not succeed in doing that.
Okay.
But I didn't really want to introduce a cutoff.
Okay.
I'm not quite sure that leads us. It may just mean that the right calculation hasn't been done yet.
So can you associate the these charges from corresponding to the super translations with vibrations of the horizon, like the question, what we think?
Well,
the answer is
quite possibly, because they are basically classified by the spherical harmonics, and that's precisely the same kind of thing. Maybe.
I thought that was what you were telling us on Tuesday, that essentially these charges are ways of describing the classical perturbations.
Yes, they are the classical perturbations due to ingoing stuff.
But the real problem is how those.
But as he points out, those will die out. Those excitations will die out.
Mm-hmm. On the horizon.
On the horizon.
So they die out asymptotically, but I'm not sure what happens to them on the horizon.
Well, they're just damped because all. I mean. Usual sort of arguments about quasi-normal modes, so they will die out.
That's the reason that that is plausible to say black holes really have no hair, because there are all these infinite number of degrees of excitation that it might be excited when the black hole forms, but they decay exponentially. Well, yeah.
Well. It's a combination of emission to infinity and into the black hole. I mean, it's just there's radiation both ways.
Well, can you define friction at the surface?
You're asking about some kind of dissipation?
Yeah.
There is for electrical resistance, so there probably is for
that's what I'm thinking.
Other things.
I've never seen it discussed, but...
Yeah.
Do the membrane people discuss it?
Sorry?
Do the membrane paradigm people
discuss it? Yes, I was thinking the membrane people should...
But I don't know very much about that.
No.
But I think, Bernard, isn't it right? If you excite a normal mode, it's going to decay on some case.
Yes. Yeah.
So I'd like to make distinguish between two separate cases. One is where you excite the quasi-normal mode outside the black hole, and it definitely decays in time. I'm not so sure what happens if the quasi-normal mode is excited on the horizon by the infalling photon or whatever it is. For example, if it's excited on the horizon and we ignore black hole evaporation for a moment, we just work with these classical charges and this classical geometry, excitations on the horizon, which we acknowledge can exist, are not going to radiate to infinity because the horizon is null. So they can radiate to the interior, possibly, but they can't radiate to the exterior.
Right. Yeah.
But now, but what, is can we connect this with what Charlie was just saying? Because if the particles are falling in are too feeble to ever emit one graviton, then they're not going to excite the modes on the black hole. Is that right? So if Charlie falls in doing this, you know, it's not it's not going to make any difference.
Well, that only makes the problem even worse, because then there's some sense there's less way to encode information in the horizon, isn't it?
Right.
Well, I think what you're asking for is to ask what effect does this have on the Hawking radiation that is going out?
Right.
That's really the question that you want to ask. It's one of the questions you want to ask.
Yes.
And at this stage, I do not know the answer to that question.
Yeah, well, I think Girard's given a partial answer, or at least tried to give a partial answer to it. But it does, though at least to skeptics like me, it's not clear how that could be a complete answer, how that could preserve unitarity by itself.
Yeah, I mean, the way so it seems to me this mechanism of the supertranslations is a way of preserving some of the information, at least, about, you know, the classical perturbations, stuff falling into the black hole, without it decaying. I mean, you know, because the perturbation in the affine parameterization of the geodesics lasts forever. It doesn't dissipate. Now, it's hard for me to see how it really encodes all the information, quantum information, that you would need to reconstruct a pure state in the exterior, for one thing. And but then, you know, what one would hope is that somehow, again, you know, I certainly don't have any detailed picture, but somehow the vacuum fluctuations, you know, which will eventually become Hawking radiation in part. I mean, as their wavelength, as their redshift and their wavelengths come in the order of the radius of the black hole, then that those, some sort of phasing of those is affected by the supertranslation distortions of the geodesics, the generators of the horizon, and that then can induce correlations in the outgoing Hawking radiation. But that's a very hand waving.
The answer is to put some meat onto that, isn't it? You've got to be able to do that calculation. That's what needs to be done.
Yeah, so that's, I think, highly non-trivial. But yeah, it certainly would be important to understand that.
Well, Leonard has a question.
Yeah, I had a question for you. The string theory formulation, although not entirely applicable to all black holes, that at least gives you a very concrete picture for some, in some situations, of, you know, deep brains and vibrating.
Yes. Streams. So what Leonard is talking about are essentially zero temperature black holes. So these are ones for which you could imagine an internal state made up of brains, and essentially you can get the entropy by counting up the number of different configurations consistent with those charges.
Right.
So that's a very concrete realization. Of course, that really is in the limit in which big G has gone to zero, because you're using a flat space argument to list the configurations.
Mm-hmm.
Nevertheless, it does reproduce the correct entropy formulae. It sort of works when you perturb away from T equals zero. And I suppose that's at some level some evidence that there is some microscopic structure associated with these things. But in that particular case, it doesn't seem to have anything to do with any horizon. After all, when you think about things like that, there are no horizons to think about. That works particularly, I mean, the picture that you're talking about also works particularly well for black holes in dimensions 4 and 5. mm-hmm. where the picture is quite clear. Outside those dimensions, it doesn't work too well. But I don't see how that fits in with these configurations at all. It's a bit of a mystery, really.
I was wondering if it was just possible to combine these kinds of concepts.
Well, maybe, yeah. Because in one case, there is a clear statistical mechanical interpretation, even if it's a bit obscured by the fact that the model doesn't seem to be entirely coherent. In this particular case, it looks like, again, you have got a series of configurations where you can identify some statistical mechanical system. But in this case, as I said, I could not satisfactorily reproduce the entropy formulae. But maybe that's just a defect of trying to do it here when too many other things are going on.
Right, right. Okay.
Still back to the basics. I'm trying to get the most basics picture. Can you play this supertranslation symmetry game in any background? Or do you need the asymptotic flatness to even define the BMS?
What I needed to make anything work nicely was a concept of an isolated horizon. So that's a null surface with topology S2 cross R, where the null is generated by its null surface, and the null geodesics that are outgoing, I assume that there is a concept of outgoing, have zero convergence.
So you are not defining the BMS group at Scry Plus?
So Scry Plus is a little bit different because that's sort of at infinity. But cosmological horizons are okay. Rindler horizons are not because they are not S2 cross R.
Can you explain why the DS space is okay and the Rindler space would be different? Because that's important. That's a statement about onerous accelerated observers detecting something completely different from black hole radiation.
I can't at the moment.
Okay.
Two questions. One is, in the case of isolated horizons, which just exist for a finite amount of affine time, can you still get an infinite number of BMS?
Yes, because there's still the BMS transformations are classified by spherical harmonics.
The super translations?
Yeah, the super translations. You see, it's just a real function of the coordinates on the sphere. So if you want that to be single valued, those are just the ordinary spherical harmonics.
So the second question is about not when you have isolated horizons, but when you have an apparent horizon instead of a null surface.
Mm-hmm.
So in the case of an apparent horizon, which isn't null, how does any of your argument go through at all?
I have no idea. I haven't tried it.
Thank you.
Well, would you agree that the same sort of supertranslation memory occurs in basically any null surface? I mean, in a certain sense. I mean,
certainly.
Any sort of object crossing, say, in a Rindler horizon in Minkowski's spacetime,
the Rindler horizon
would generate, supertranslations in the Rindler horizon.
Yes, well, that's a follow-up to Larry's question about the Rindler horizon. I'm not sure about Rindler horizons. There has to be something different about those.
I don't see how, but what I would say is different is that vacuum fluctuations on the Rindler horizon stay vacuum fluctuations. They don't become Hawking radiation.
Right.
Anyway, and it's only because, for the black hole case, they become Hawking radiation that they really have any physical consequence. But anyway,
it's worth remembering, though, that the things that become Hawking radiation are really modes not on the horizon, but just outside the horizon.
Well, it's definitely close.
They have to be close to the horizon, but they're not right. They're not strictly on the horizon, or they wouldn't get out. They have to be, they're really, strictly speaking, modes outside the horizon. Those are the ones that you need to imprint if you're going to produce correlations in the Hawking radiation that will carry away information.
Yeah, but, a Hawking radiation at late times is associated with highly subplancian right. distances, you know, modes which have highly subplancian wavelengths within highly subplancian distances from the horizon at early times. So, you know, to all practical purposes, they're on the horizon.
Thank you.
Well, we've got another.
Yes, I should say this is very early days. I mean.
Well, I didn't mean to put you on the spot, but I just thought you raised so many interesting questions in your talk that haven't been resolved, and we have a few minutes. Yes. It was useful to air them and see if we can make any more progress.
And the firewall question is the other one, but I know you don't have the answer to that yet.
I have nothing to say about firewall.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, I suppose if Faye is ready to go.